Yaskawa. You're watching the IEC 61131 Basics video tutorial series on the topic of timers and sequencing. Hi, I'm Matt Pelletier, and we'll continue in this section to develop our parking gate control example project with a simple application of IEC 61131 timers and look at function block sequencing. Let's add some timer functionality now to our application. We have the sensor, and as the car hits that sensor and drives forward, we would like to have some delay time between when the gate actually closes and the car moves off the sensor. This way we would be more sure that the car doesn't get hit by the closing gate. With any of the timers in IEC 61131, there is a PT input, and this is the time input, which uses the time data type. We have seen this here before. Let's just go through it. Here's a few examples of the correct initial value, or the values that you can use for the time data type: T pound 5S, T pound 5.0S, or even the word time pound, and for 5 seconds, 5S. We could look at the help, and under literals, you would see other formats. So what I'd like to do as a preliminary exercise is let's create a new LD ladder POU called timers in the fast task, and then let's add one of each timer. You can see the three basic IEC 61131 timers, and then you have a way to test each of these out and see how they work and go through and turn on the input with the same delay time and see what happens with the output and the elapsed time. And then as you implement and observe each of these timers, keep in mind which timer might be the most appropriate way to implement our application, where we'd like the gate output to stay on for an additional delay time. So as before, I encourage you to try to do this here on your own. Pause it, and then I will go through my solution. Okay, so here's what you do. You go to logical POUs, and let's insert timers as a ladder. Before I forget, I'll run that here in the fast task, probably right below main. So let's insert the program instance here, timers, and the program type again, timers, match those up. All right, runs right after main. Now, opening up timers here, I could add under the function block group — timers are function blocks — I have these three here, T off, T on, and TP. So let's put in one of each, T off, and I'll take the default name. Remember, you can also type these in, T on and TP. And please recall also, anytime you use a new block, you can right click on it for help. And you see here the description, it's an off delay timer. It's looking for input changing from true to false, rather than from false to true, and a timing diagram of how that works. So let's give it an input called toff_in. And then I'll arrow down here to give it a delay of data type time. And let's have an initial value of T pound 5S, 5 seconds. And for this test, I will not put anything on the outputs. I'll just monitor it here. Now for the T on timer, let's call this input ton_in. And one little trick here: to copy a variable, you can hold down the control. I'm holding down control and I'm clicking and dragging. And you can see I've generated a copy of that. Line that up. Sometimes that's useful. Let me scroll down here. TP_in. And you can also do a copy and paste. Okay, now a download changes. Okay, so we can close the resource window, go to debug mode, and let's try to turn on this T off input. And what happens? The output is on, and it's not counting the elapsed time. It's looking for, as we had mentioned, the falling edge. So let's turn this back off. And there it goes, it's counting up. And the output turns off after the elapsed time. Now how about T on? Let's turn a T on to true. And that one begins counting right away. And then the output turns on after the elapsed time. And how about TP? Let's turn this one on. So it first turns the output on and counts immediately, and then turns the output off after the amount of time. TP in the help says it creates a pulse. So when you have the input go from false to true, a pulse is created for the duration of that input. So we're creating a pulse for a certain amount of time. Another test to do on this is a momentary input. And so either you got to be real quick on your debug mode, or else we could try toggle boolean. I'll do toggle boolean really quick. Remember how to do this? You turn off debug mode, go to your boolean variables, and turn on TB checkbox for each of these, and download the changes. Okay, close the resource, and back here to debug mode. I now go to my online menu and turn on toggle boolean. And now with toggle boolean, by the way, it's not showing up yellow because of the show borders. This blue background is overriding that, but it'll still work. I'll click on it. It's on. You can see if I click on it while it's running, it'll cancel it and do it again. Then how about this one? I'll click this one real quick. I gotta hold it down. I'm holding it down, it's counting, I let go, it clears. So this one you gotta hold down that input. And then here, okay, this one's already on. You can turn it back off. Otherwise, if I wanna make a positive pulse, I'll need to real quick turn off toggle boolean. Start it off at a false, and then go back into toggle boolean values. And now I can click real quick here, this pulse. And you can see I don't need to leave that one on, and it counts the time. So I would like to implement this with the TP timer. I'm sure the other timers could also be used with a different approach. And I'll use the timer output in the rung that opens G gate open. And additionally, the sensor input, G sensor, will be used in parallel with that. And then in order to invert the input so that I'm looking at the sensor turning off, I'll change the properties and negate the input. So let's update our code now with debug mode off. And then in the main POU, there's a way to insert space. You right click, insert either columns or in this case rows. Insert rows a couple times. And then I'll put in my TP. And as the input, we have G underscore sensor. And as the output, we're calling it timer. And for PT, I'll use G underscore delay time, which we created in a previous video. And now to edit the ladder, you can click on the rung and do contact right, and then a parallel contact. This first contact will be G sensor. So I want the gate to open as the cars come in. And then timer in parallel with that. So the idea here is that when the sensor turns off, it could create a pulse for an additional amount of time that would keep the gate open for an additional amount of time past when the sensor keeps it open. But to do that, I need to look at the sensor turning off. And there's several ways to do this, and I just would like to show that if you double click on a block, you can go down to its properties, and it's possible to negate or hide different inputs and outputs. So I would like to negate the in input, and that puts this little circle on here. And what that means then is that it's the same as if you would have put a normally closed contact. If I would have put something like this in front with the G sensor, that would be the equivalent. Another way to do this would be to use the not function block in front of it. But I wanted to do it using the negate property. So let's observe how this works with download changes. Okay, and so now we'll go to debug mode so we can check this out. And we'll start here in the simulator. I'll open us up for business. And now we'll hit the sensor. So we hit the sensor, the car comes up, the gate opens. And if I let go of the sensor, I click it again. If the run off the sensor, the gate stays open for the elapsed time. I'm doing 2 seconds on this one. Of course, you could always change that if I wanted T pound 5S like before. You can tab here to overwrite. Turn the sensor on, turn the sensor off. Gate stays open for 5 seconds. And then I'd mentioned that in the help on IEC 61131 that the area on literals tells how to format time. Here's some examples. You can use milliseconds, minutes, hours. So how about I'll try one of those. We could do a delay time of T pound 1 second 400 milliseconds. Basically 1.4 seconds. You overwrite that. Yeah, puts it in there as 1.4. And now turn it on and turn it off. Works fine. Now in this section on timers, let's finish off with what I'm calling timer sequencing. Anytime you have a function block that takes some time to execute, they can be sequenced together in the way shown here, where one output just triggers the next. But there's a commonly used ladder logic assembly called sealant circuit, which I think it's also a good time to look at using this R-trig, rising edge trigger. So if we have an input called start and it has a rising edge, it will create, this R-trig will create a pulse, a one scan pulse. And then as long as the active input is on, this pulse created from the previous rung will come down and energize the sealed coil, which then in parallel here seals itself in, so it stays on. So we start with a rising edge, just an input that may be momentary, and we end up with a sealed on Boolean variable. And then this sealed on can be used to have a maintained on input and allow the sequence to complete regardless of the state of the start input. So once you give it that start input, it will complete the sequence. So let's create that here together in the timers POU. Leaving debug mode, we'll go up to timers. And let's scroll down here and put in a ladder network. Wanted to call this variable start. And then there's the R-trig. It's a function block again because it takes place over several scans. R-trig, rising edge trigger. And you can put that one right on the ladder rung. We wanted to call this one pulse. Okay. Moving down, we can create another network. And we'll take now pulse and contact right for active. These are the two inputs here, start and active. If you don't have active, there's no way to deactivate the whole sequence and start it over. We got sealed. And then here in parallel, we'll put again sealed. This is another way to enter, okay. All right, next network, we'll take sealed and timer one underscore done. I need to put on a T on timer. There I see it. T on, can stick it right on the rung. It says T on number two. Goes on just like that. We can use the same delay here if you want. Delay. And we'll make three of these in sequence. And it makes sense here to do a copy. You can copy this whole rung with Control C and then place your cursor down, Control V to paste. Oh, got a little extra there. Get rid of that. And then you just update your inputs. This was timer one done, and we wanted to have this be called timer two done. However, there's going to be an issue, and I wanted to show this on purpose. When you make after a paste like this, let's see what happens. We have an error. It says here, six errors and two warnings. Function block corresponding to T on three, not found. Function block not found, not found. It says it can't find the inputs to this block. And that's at first seems like kind of a strange error. But if you look here at the timers V, the variables for timers, and for ease, let's just sort by name by double clicking the column. You can see that I have a T on one and a T on two, but it's complaining that there is no T on three. You see, what happens is when you paste a block, it doesn't paste the what they call the instance, that this title above it. So all you need to do is click on it and click OK after you paste. It's kind of like the confirmation that you truly did want to paste it. And then here in timers V, now we do have T on three. So that very simple step is important. And a make now will be successful with zero errors. Okay, so I'll paste one more time here. And update this here. This was timer one. I'll scroll down here with my mouse click wheel down to number two, timer two. And this one was called last timer underscore done. And then don't forget to double click on T on four. Click OK. If you want to, you can check the variables. Okay, it's got the instance there of it. And we'll download changes. And now let's test it out. We'll close the resource, open to debug. And I'll adjust my window here. First, I'll activate. And then I can turn on the start input. And I can even turn it back off because it's momentary. See already here, the seal circuit sealed in and it's going down through here. And doing all of these timers in sequence. So this method applies to any type of sequence. Looking ahead here to motion programming, these could be, for example, steps to a homing sequence or steps to any type of move sequence when you're starting off with an input to trigger that whole sequence. And all you really want from that input is a rising edge, just some type of trigger to get the whole sequence going without requiring that input to stay on. So thank you. That's it for timers and sequencing.